Some nights are just pitch black, without stars and without sleep. Dirty nights clinging to you like tar. Like this one night, back in 1938. Boston. The Great Depression tsunami was just sweeping over what was left of America. Misery, hunger, despair. Times are hard, they said. Times were worse than hard. And the bar was about to close. As far as I was concerned, this was just another intoxicated day drawing to an end. If only I knew.
Now that's an intro. I love games that have amazing intros to them.
The shock was still echoing in my bones as the image of that girl coming out of nowhere surged back in my mind. Did I hit her? Was she dead? I couldn't remember. Thoughts were spinning in my head. I hope I didn't run her over. I hope she's still alive. Then, the pain, the terrible pain on my side. And this question, where am I?
Thank you.
this girl on the road, the impact, I couldn't find her body. The box seemed to be connected to electric lightning of the lighting of the street. No body, no blood. Where did the girl disappear? Have I killed her? Who is that girl who crossed the road? I couldn't avoid her. But I never found her body. I couldn't get her desperate stare out of my mind, but I was wounded and I needed help. Vesper Manor didn't ring a bell. My head was empty and painful. I could read the name Vesper on the mailbox, that name. Nah, ever since the commotion, my memory seemed like gone.
Trying to collect my thoughts, but the intense pain was scattering them like a bunch of dead birds. My fear of being wounded changed into an obsession. Was I about to die?
For sale, this board looks like as old as the house. It's quite a drop. The bucket fell down a dozen meters at least, no way to recover it. Thinking this was a premonition was probably just superstition, but I definitely felt uneasy. This unknown symbol let out a powerful aura. William Vesper, no date on the grave. Statue was staring at me with a wide and hostile stare. I couldn't help but think about that statue's broken arm. Someone had obviously moved it recently, but I couldn't help thinking it was some kind of desecration. bucket had not been used for a long time. A metallic shard in the dark caught my eye. B. Norman. This name coming from nowhere was chilling. Margaret Vesper, born Venture Cross. On the grave, the name Margaret Vesper seemed to challenge eternity itself. Who was she? The grave looked as daunting as a forgotten tomb. What a dire way of decorating a garden. The arm came from a marble structure. There was still some golden liquid inside the glass. The glass was still moist and the chair was overlooking the garden. Someone was there very recently. If that person were to come back, my wound would be the only acceptable reason for breaking in. Old and damp planks, which had fallen from the front of the mansion. Couldn't see a thing, the window was watching over a tomb. Someone was here recently. To William Vesper, under normal circumstances, I would have never tried to contact you. I'm an honest woman. I've supported my husband since the blessed day of our wedding, from which two beautiful children were born. I've given them the best education I could, but today I cannot afford to raise them properly anymore. We are ruined. My husband's employer went bankrupt. He is traveling from town to town trying to find a job while I have to beg for food. To beg for food every single day. My four-year-old son has had a bad cough, which is getting worse, and I fear for his life. Nowadays, we can see children die in the streets. Is this still America? I beg of you, who are rich, only a few dollars would be enough. We could work for you. We live in the shack under the best oil sign at the entrance of the slum. By the Graham Slaughterhouse. Don't hesitate to come, Martha Kenton. The landlord was out, said he might be around somewhere.
No one around. I was all alone, with my pain growing and some nausea starting up. Don't stop. Think quick. Think well. It was just an accident. It happens. The girl must have made it out alive. I had to make it out alive, too.
No one answered my calls. Either someone was hiding in there or the house was empty. In both cases, that wouldn't be very helpful to me. I needed a key. Metallic shard, though. Maybe we can get in through the back door. W plus S, I would have considered that romantic under other circumstances. Check these boards real quick. My guess is it's in the graveyard somewhere. Footprints leading to the cemetery, huh? Okay. The key was probably hidden nearby. The birdbath? No key here. But the dead probably kept the burglars away.
I had the feeling I was about to desecrate a sanctuary. To open the door to a world I didn't belong to. But whoever lived in there, they would understand. I needed help. Anyone would understand that. Somewhere safe. That's all that mattered. As the doors opened, the mansion seemed to react to my presence. There was a smell, like a cornered animal. The smell of fear. And yet, I entered the place because I had no choice. I was praying to find a phone or some help. I didn't even bother wondering what happened to prayers when they reached the wrong door.
Hello? Hello? I need an ambulance. Can you hear me? I need help.
What happened? This cold. The darkness around me. I was usually not afraid of the dark. But there, on that day, I remembered I had a matchbox somewhere in my jacket. The urge to light a match was growing with every new chill running down my spine.
A man was living there. The boots have been used very recently. A soothing aura was surrounding this lunar goddess statue. The small statue of a lunar goddess that stood in the parlor felt like a comforting presence. September 5th, 1910, William's 6-year-old, daydreaming already. The garden looked like it was sleeping in the darkness. Seeing the woman with the church candle, I was wondering where God was. A boy with religious dress, a house full of old traditions. August 28th, 1911. William is 7 today. He is with Henry running around the servants in the garden. Dressed up like monsters from space. Games, always games. The mansion is all upside down, and their yells gave me an awful headache. I'm now cloistered in the office, unable to even pray. Henry's fantasies kept William away from his great destiny. I have to bring him back to me, as this will be my only chance to make a man out of him, to make him embrace the center, the Venture Cross legacy, to show him the way. Henry's a dreamer. He has no ambition whatsoever. He can't teach him anything. Behind every great man, there is a great woman. Nonsense. Women should be on the front line. This is where the opposite brought us. I have no illusion about how little power the world is leaving in the hands of women. But William is young. He is the future. I will act through him. And may night finally fall upon the house. May William stop running after deceiving lights to find a place he deserves in this world. crucifix was not comforting at all. Nothing special about the wardrobe. Vesper to landlords for sure, but not a very smiling couple. Whoever that was, it currently didn't ring a bell. The armchair looked comfy. I could get some rest and save some shit. I don't know. It's a safe spot.
Are you there?
Excuse me, sorry. All right, well, we can run now. Box full of old science books.
Either. I had to be more badly wounded than I thought.
I saw a surreal woman crossing the doors like plumes of smoke. Her out-of-this-world beauty was extraordinary. Was it my imagination? Was she the girl on the road? That would explain why there was no body. Some African mask, a wooden face without a soul. That woman with dark hair was dominating the room. Who was she? Who answered? I couldn't forget that sound. Prisoner. Once inside the house, I tried to use the phone to call for help, but the answer was scrambled and unintelligible. Who was it? As a chill went down my spine, the entrance door locked itself behind me. Encyclopedias, the edge was hardly readable. Two men on a small boat, a memory from an expedition. This mountain landscape couldn't soothe me. Sheet music was taken away from that glass case. The box lid was displaying an esoteric symbol. The box is closed. There's a small opening for a key. Small music box with a secret inside. I could feel it shudder under my fingers. The symbol of Venus was engraved on the lid. The globe was covered in scribblings. The windows had no handle on a very unhelpful peculiarity. The gramophone could only play silent dust.
Decided to accept her presence. After all, from all those weird things I had seen that night, she was the only one who hadn't tried to kill me.
It seemed that using the gramophone made the girl appear, but it wasn't enough. She needed more, apparently. That puzzle was missing a piece, a link between her and the contraption. Dearest William, you wanted to know more about me? Last time I didn't tell you everything. This letter will make up for this. When I arrive in California in 1930, I'm only 18. This is a marvelous place, and the weather is so nice. I spend hours on the beach, astonished to see how brown my Norwegian skin can become. In the evening, I hang near the jazz clubs. In the afternoon, I watch people play on the beach, humming the tunes I heard that night before. Sometimes I try to sing louder than the waves. It's a good exercise. My English is quickly improving thanks to the American songs I already knew in Oslo at the time. I am barely aware of the social misery that is devouring your country. I am young. I want to be beautiful, to meet people my age, and to sing. In Los Angeles, at the Spice Club, I meet the members of a jazz band. They are talented and funny. We play all night. I forget about the hour and about my parents. They even call the police at the end of the night. The musicians tell me they are looking for a singer and that they want me. I can hardly believe it. Have you ever felt that you finally belong somewhere? It feels fantastic. Was it the moon standing alone in the middle of everything?
This thing looked like it was reaching out from some fairy tale. The kind of stories in which kids get devoured by some witch in a dark forest. Was it real?
February 6, 1932. Of all the bars I visited, the smoke and mirrors appear to have been especially tailored for me. People that are quiet, melancholic, even. They stagnate in the swirling smoke of their cigarettes, like convicts, desperate victims. They were pushed to darkness by the crisis, but even if the bar isn't an elegant place, they are not driven away. They respect their right to oblivion. It is a place where they can despair. I found myself a corner from which I can watch their comings and goings until I'm carried to the abyss by my own whiskey. Every time I'm caught again by the band, such good musicians. Their music is like a tear that time stretches. Slow jazz, steady and reserved. It is the music of someone. It is the music of their time, the music of those who fell on the wayside. Someone told me about a singer who just got hired. Well, I don't think the band needs that, but we'll see.
Delusion or not, I tried not to think about it. Only a madman can think mad things.
There's barely any humanity left in the man's stare. This portrait woman had been cut with a knife. A harbor, empty boats on water. An appointment with destiny. For too many of us, the political equality we once had won was meaningless in the face of economy inequality. A small group had concentrated into their own hands and almost complete control over other people's property, other people's money, other people's labor, other people's lives. Far too many of us live life was no longer free, liberty no longer real, men could no longer follow the pursuit of happiness. Against economy tyranny such as this, the American citizen could appeal only to organized power of government. The collapse of 1929 showed up the deposition for what it was. The election of 1932 was the people's mandate to end it. Under that mandate, it is being ended. Franklin Delano Roosevelt, June 27th, 1936. A note to self. I'm so tired. Father ordered leather club chairs from a Quincy Craftsman. They are perfect. It is one of the few places where I can rest and think. Margaret couldn't touch them, and I have no idea why. Maybe because they are marked with a sun, which made her blind. I don't know. I'm just happy they are here. Thank you, Father. A landscape frozen in time, quite like the face around it. A log, a good start if I wanted to start a fire. Note to self, kitchen key. My dear friend, for lack of sleep erodes your sanity as well as your memory. I hereby decide to put the kitchen key in the book of recipes Father loved so much. It is in the library and won't move from there, which will prevent you from having to make extra keys again. Please start by trying not to lose this note. Your devoted servant, yourself, William. The menu for the diner for dinner seemed to be good 20 years late. Could be an ally, but I needed to find some wood. I need more wood to get the fire really roaring. A log. Good start if I wanted to start a fire. Touching that disc was warm and comforting, and I felt an urge to listen to it. Lipstick, crucifix, astronomy books, such treasure. In September 1934, during a concert at the Red Bait, we met Jim Erziger, a producer whose label Two Roads is becoming prominent. After the show, he tells me I have a marvelous voice and that my Norwegian accent brings something unique to our African-American jazz music, that it is enough to get the attention of amateurs and curious listeners. I have to admit, Norwegian jazz singers are not that many, but I can't really believe he would hire us. But he does. He suggests we name the band Selena and the Frozen Sons. I am to be paid for singing. Everything looks so simple. Dad used to say that anything can grow in California. I feel like a flower finding its way through the snow. But my parents are not happy for me. I think they are homesick. But I am 22. Life is an adventure, and I don't know much about life. I know nothing of pain, for example. Everything changes. W. Vesper, he had the stare of a broken man and a lost soul. William Vesper's Diary, Expert number 9, May 11th, 1928. It has been a year already since Sarah died of pneumonia. In a few months after Winterstone became disabled following his heart attack. They were my only friends. Today the house is empty like every day, filled only with my own echoes and these things I don't want to hear anymore. I miss Father so much. I still see him playing by my side. I see him put his hands on the piano keys, humming as he was playing music. I think about leaving, but then I wonder, what would that change anyway? Night is everywhere. She would find me. First I have to make my big plan come true and learn how to live again. I listen to Jack Hilton's Wonderful You, and I realize I'll never have anyone to play with. This is what I need, some company. A companion. The city's so close. I guess it is time to leave. They have electricity and light there. That music is mere presence, gave me hope.
Jazz record. Selena Sandvik. The key she left me was an invitation. Was she trying to help me? Or was I heading towards even more troubles?
This said the girl was called Selena Sandvik, a jazz singer from Norway. She had two gifts for me, her voice, who could seduce even the darkness, and a key. Though it didn't mention which door it was supposed to open.
I had to focus. Surviving is a full-time job. Not the kind of job you can afford to lose.
Sultry Sun's poetry, the last thing I had in mind. The key was an invitation, but to which? Not to the kitchen. Maybe the library? Here, since I haven't really checked. Note to self, Mother's shadows. Mother's shadows will never go away. I understand it now, calling them quote-unquote ghosts would still be too normal. It is a filth that strives in the dark like flies on manure. As long as I am alive, they will never go away. Who could hang a picture of a headless woman on a wall? In the eyes of the old man, you can see wisdom and sadness. Margaret Vesperney Vintercross, a woman as noble as cold. Margaret and Henry Vesper, two strangers pretending to be married. One of the paintings that had the name Margaret Venter, the same as the grave outside, the woman's stare was as noble as frozen lake and looked just as cold. Another apparition, but that one smelt like death. I couldn't move close to it. It was an old lady, a corrupt soul, death itself. I had to stay away from it.
Through doors either. I had to be more badly wounded than I thought. thing looked like it was reaching out from some fairy tale. The kind of stories in which kids get devoured by some witch in a dark forest. Was it real? Delusion or not, I tried not to think about it. Only a madman can think mad things. Decided to accept her presence. After all, from all those weird things I had seen that night, she was the only one who hadn't tried to kill me.
Apparently there's no light switch.
Her, that girl from the jazz record, Selena Sandvik. The key she left me was an invitation. Was she trying to help me? Or was I heading towards even more troubles? I had to focus. Surviving is a full-time job. Not the kind of job you can afford to lose.
High heel shoe, maybe it's the owner was still here. Woman's shoe was lying on the floor of the corridor. I chose not to touch it. Something here felt like agony. Margaret's Diary, excerpt 19. And this is good old Boston, the home of the bean and the cod, where Lowell's talk only to Cabot's, and the Cabot's talk only to God. A Boston toast by John Colin Bosty, Boston Bream's anthem. Cousins, uncles, their faces are shared by the same concern. God, that old biddy's still there. Boston Brangham's June 6, 1938. In these troubled times, one would dream about the curious past of our city, about the founding fathers who built them and strengthened their walls. They would be the Boston Brahams, the bigwigs, the businessmen, the lawyers, and the soldiers, whose sense of morality helped draw the lines of the city and gave it soul. And what a soul without them, Boston would be the one of those many little towns of the East Coast. Thanks to them, in less than a century, became the major economic, financial, and cultural center we all know. And while we can see those who will build a century to come, the newly graduated from Harvard, symbol of the city's pursuit of excellence, let us keep in mind the spirit of pioneers whose clear speech inherited from New England still sings in T.S. Eliot's poems and in the voice of Katharine Hepburn. 8 years ago, Malcolm Nicholas resigned from office. He was the last of the Brigham, the last Republican to hold the mayor's office. But it is still here, this noble blood, which built roads, schools, churches, courthouses, and hospitals. An economic crisis, no matter how dire it is, will never wash away their dignity.
Locked, of course, and no way to know what was waiting behind it.
Excuse me. Well, let's go back and save just in case. Alright, the music box. When I think of that, of course. Okay. Oh, I didn't pick up the key. Dirt. Dirt. Okay. Okay, so that's not the key for that. Summer of 1912, my only family after father's death, their voices, their footsteps, their lies, I missed them all. Margaret's diary, excerpt number 18, April 2nd, 1914. Spring came and the blooming flowers and the source of unbearable allergies. The shadow of Henry and his ancestors is haunting the mansion. The place is mine now, and I am busy trying to give it a suitable appearance. William won't like it, but so be it. He has to learn that the power to change things has to be earned. I'm still his mother. He doesn't seem to understand what meant to be a Boston Braham, and it was only when I grew older that I really understood what it meant. I tried picking the best words, savoring their meaning today, teaching them the part. His ancestry, John Vinter, who arrived in Boston in 1710, had played in the building of the city. The duty on the shoulder of a New England Protestant elite. I ended it with these words, "We are the past and the future of the city, William." He shrugged and went to play the piano. There's way too much of his father in this child. Original copy of Debussy's Clair de Lune. just gonna save one more time, but damn. What is locked? Suffocating this useless illuminations and frills in the mansion doesn't have the greatest benefiting fortune like the Vespers. It's like the work of a degenerating romantic. It's like a stain in the century. I ordered the flower beds on the east side of the garden to be removed. They made moving around complicated, and in summer, their scent was unbearable. I didn't talk about it to Henry, and he was quite upset. For the first time, I think I saw something like rage in his eyes. For a few seconds, he did look like a man. Then he shut himself back in his melancholy and played the piano all afternoon. His jazz again, this stupid music which reeks of debauchery and misery. Note to self, the shadows avoid the electric light. Tonight, one of Mother's shadows caught me as I was walking inside the library. That same day, I had someone fix the electrical wiring, which had been out of service for years. In panic, I switched on the light. The shadow vanished in a scream. Electric light kills them. The moon, I have never needed her light here. The moonlight was glowing behind these curtains. These gashed portraits were not my favorite decoration. The mother of men, my mother, you allow me to be a man. Although disturbing, the knife had a role to play in that tragedy. It clearly wasn't art, just the fantasy of a murderer. Note to self, she's suing me. Her voice is harassing me, blaming me, and insulting me because I was not the heir she wanted so much. Margaret is even more harmful in death, and because I am her son, she has always possessed the keys to my mind. I'm desperate. How am I supposed to keep a dead person at bay? Three graves, three names, Maria, Irina, and Virginia. Irina, Virginia, and Maria, three paintings, three women portraits. Someone added a blade as decoration, creating a grim but maybe meaningful display. Geometric symbols. These shapes gave me a headache. Although my ideas were still very confused, the symbols had an effect on me. Kind of symbo, esoteric, alchemical, has enough to turn someone's blood to ice. Margaret's diary excerpt. December 12th, 1895. I want him to stop. God, is he still my father? I wish things would be like they were before. Going to the fair, to the races, when he told me the names of the horses he knew so well. When he let me bet.
What happened?
Then laughed at me because I lost. I want him to tell me more about our family, about Kenneth Cross, bravery. When he fought the English soldiers during the Tea Party. About Uncle Hardy, the captain of a Union warship fighting slavery. About the senator and poet Douglas Venter. About Tom Kinston, member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. All great men, knights, intellectuals. Glorious members of the Venter Cross family. But what will people say about that? Whoever did this clearly had real issues with women. Note to self, the shadow. Shadow's mode? Mother, should I say, what is left of her seems to evolve over time. First, she was very static, as if trapped in her own nightmare. Now she's moving around the house as she used to when she was blind, shortly before she died. Margaret is waiting behind the doors, where she is standing in the obscene and twisted postures inherited from her insane mind. Cannot move without fearing her claws. William Vesper's diary excerpt number 3. March 10th, 1935. The bone fragments and the weapons found by Riviera at the Mexican dig site of Tichunichon are here at last. He was true to his word, but I still paid God good money for it. The Mesoamerican pyramids of the site was among the biggest of the region, although they were built 2 centuries before Christ. The human remains were found under the pyramid of the moon, confirmed my theories. These victims were probably sacrifices. Riviera tells me he found at least 4 of them with their arms tied behind their back. They were sacrificed to the Greek goddess of Teotihuacan, a great honor. The knife is very well preserved. Since I sharpened it, it seems ready to serve the goddess again. I must study the rites of the killing ceremony. I'll ask the bodies to be shipped to me. Thank you. I made a discovery that would very well save my life. Electricity killed the ghost. Could death itself die? The landlord had crates full of books and delivered to him. Recipe from France and French islands. Tahitian raw fish. Ingredients are 6. 1 pound of sushi grade raw fish diced into 1/2-inch cubes. 1/2 pound of raw shrimps diced. 2 green limes. 6 yellow limes. 2 shallots. 1 glass of coconut milk. 2 carrots grated. 1 tomato diced. Salt, pepper. Preparation. Dice the fish and the shrimps into 1/2-inch cubes. Squeeze the limes and pour the juice over the fish. Let marinate overnight. In the morning, drain the extra juice, lime juice, and keep it on the side. Add the coconut milk and mix. Add minced shallots, grated carrots, and diced tomato. Add salt and pepper if needed, and some lime juice. Keep chilled and present on a bed of green salad and grated carrots. It was holding the key tightly, praying that it would be useful. Mayan drawings. Probably the owner had some real education. Reasons for the crisis. October 18th, 1932. The current crisis is a sickness born from capitalism, from speculation, like a blind madness forged in 3 sins. Greed. The wealth of the Great War was jealousy kept since 1918 in the safes of those who were wealthy again, wealthy already, and didn't benefit the economy of the people. Lack of experience. A weak economy balancing was shattered to pieces by the restrictive policies of the Federal Reserve, still too young and unwilling to take bold actions. Fear, by refusing to supply money to the banks in order to encourage spending. The Fed actually was at the origin of the credit crunch, which pushed people to withdraw their money from the banks, and in the end brought the whole system to its knees. The bleeding would cause the system to fail. The crash to happen wasn't supposed to happen, could have been avoided if someone had enough courage to face the few men who were ransacking America. The people should ask Mr. Hoover where he was when water started flooding the ship. Do it, don't think, said the voice in my head. Stick it. Victim of the crisis, October 19, 1934. The body of a 40-year-old man was found yesterday morning in the Burns Industrial Area. According to the police, the death is the result of severe malnutrition coupled with massive alcohol ingestion. He is the 4th person to be found dead as a result of starvation this week in the neighborhood, where many factories have closed and the unemployment rate reaches 60%. The authorities seem unable to face the malnutrition and alcoholism issues and community itself can't take over from the official institutions to face the crisis. The government doesn't seem to have the power to save its own citizens, or maybe doesn't want to. Alright, so we gotta find another knife to stab the portrait with. And I've been avoiding this room over here where I heard a knocking, but okay. Yeah, I'm guessing I got the key to the kitchen. No, of course it wasn't a coincidence. done fucked myself because I don't have matches. Note to self, matchboxes. I place matchboxes all over the house in the case the electrical wiring breaks down. It's really the last thing I wish would happen. Once a meal, now an offering to flies. Oh, nice. Dishes in the sink were now full of life. Maggots, I guess. Despite its tired look, the fridge was still working. In a pan, some indistinct shape was still warm. William Vesper Diary, excerpt number 21, July 9th, 1922. Cursed that Volstead Act. It has been a week since Winterstone got me some bourbon. Ever since police seized the Beckford distillery, the whole city is dry. I will need to smuggle alcohol in the next cargo ship leaving from Anang. That Asian alcohol is burning my bowels, but I have no other choice. It will take weeks. These damn corrupted cops can sleep without a worry. No one is coming out of the dark to attack them at night. Such a stupid and hypocritical paternalism. What's left for the poor? Before taking care of my health, you should wonder if it will make me feel better. I should go out, try to find new contacts, but the shadows will chase me outside, and when I'm driving especially, who knows what could happen. Bitch, no. Screw you, bitch, no! Just a picture, I thought, and I stuck the blade. Map of the ground floor would probably be helpful. Lost and overtaken, I was the floor plan showed up on the right time.